If you're simulating a liquid within a domain that causes a significant pressure drop, it may become necessary to include cavitation effects. Sometimes this is a known simulation objective up front, but sometimes the cavitation is an unexpected phenomenon. I've had cases in the past where customers were simply analyzing a liquid flow, but were getting negative absolute pressures in the flow domain. After some additional investigation, we determined through simulation that the flow in their device was indeed cavitating. In this video, I'll show you how to add basic cavitation effects and share a few tips on getting a stable solution. We can use this converging-diverging nozzle for an example geometry with water as the working fluid. To enable cavitation, we first need to choose a multiphase model. So I'll go ahead and add both liquid and vapor from the materials list, and then activate the multiphase model. This can work with either mixture or volume of fluid, but I'll choose mixture for this example. We can assign our primary and secondary phases here, then name them for future reference, then click Apply. To enable cavitation, we go to the Heat and Mass Reactions tab, and then choose Cavitation from the drop-down menu, and Liquid to Vapor for the phases. From here, we need to know the vapor pressure of the liquid. By default, Fluent already has the approximate vapor pressure of water at room temperature, so I won't need to change this. If you have large temperature gradients, you can also set vapor pressure as a function of temperature. I'll stick with the Schnur-Sauer model for this example. A full explanation of both models here is given in the theory guide. The bubble number density isn't really something I have any information for, so the default should be fine for my case. For the boundary conditions, I'll use a pressure inlet and a pressure outlet. The reason for this is because in a nozzle example, when cavitation occurs, it will actually change the effective throat area, and there will be a point where the flow gets choked, meaning that mass flow rate will stop changing regardless of the driving pressure. If I just arbitrarily choose some mass flow or velocity for the inlet, I could get a completely unrealistic flow condition. So here, I'll leave the outlet at atmosphere and add 1 bar to the inlet pressure. For the inlet volume fraction, I'll go pure liquid and leave the vapor at 0. For the outlet, I will change the vapor backflow fraction from a constant value to from neighboring cell, so we aren't just introducing extra vapor arbitrarily if any backflow occurs. I've also added a slip wall extension here to help mitigate the backflow. When modeling cavitation, I like to track the minimum absolute pressure in the domain, along with volume fraction of vapor in the domain, and the maximum velocity. In addition to mass balance, these are good things to track for determining convergence. Speaking of mass balance, I'm tracking both inlet and outlet mass flows since we're assigning pressures at the boundaries. So I'll use the hybrid initialization just to get a good initial pressure gradient, and then patch in a velocity in the flow direction just to make sure everything starts off moving in the right direction. Now the solution is converged, and we can see some cavitation occurring around the throat as would be expected. So this is the general setup and procedure, but I want to show you a couple of things to look out for when doing this on your own. First, the mass balance will bounce around quite a bit during the solve. This is to be expected, since the total volume fraction of vapor in the domain will change quite a bit during the solution process. Beyond that, vapor pockets and bubbles will shift around quite a bit during the iterations, and this is going to cause a lot of density variations in the domain. The composition at the outlet will change a lot during this process, which will have a pretty significant effect on the calculated outlet mass flow. Some backflow will likely happen during the solution as well, since there's a big pressure gradient happening here, and that might take several iterations to become physically realistic. The next thing to consider is that residuals probably won't converge monotonically. This is also related to the vapor distribution, and in my experience, the residuals tend to oscillate a fair amount during the solution process. So don't freak out if you see this. They typically don't behave very well with steady-state multiphase models in general. And finally, you might need to do a lot of iterations to get a converged solution. There's a lot going on here, so it takes the solver a bit of time to find the right solution. Finally, if your case is diverging, here's a couple of tips that might help you stabilize the solution. First, make sure you have a good mesh resolution where you expect the cavitation to occur. Also, consider your initial conditions. Sometimes you have to patch in a non-zero vapor fraction to start with. Also, try different solvers. In this case, Fluent defaulted to simple, but if I couldn't get a solution here, I would consider switching to coupled pseudo-transient and turning down the timescale factor. Finally, if you're using pressure inlets and outlets, try starting with a low delta P and then increase it gradually until you can get to the point that you actually want to simulate. So this was my quick overview on setting up cavitation and what to watch out for when using it. Thanks for watching.